New series that we begin today entitled Unleash, and we're praying that God is going to unleash His grace, His power, His blessing in your life in 2015, unlike any other previous year. That, you know, walking with Jesus just gets better and better, and God has more for you and I in this new year than we could ever begin to imagine. Matter of fact, Ephesians 3:20 says that God's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think according to His power that's at work within us. And so we are praying that as we go through this series together, talking about what it means to experience the unleashing power of God in your life, that you will experience it in a very personal and practical way. It's so good to see each and every one of you. I know we have some overflow people out in Trinity Central watching around the TV screen. We're excited. We're glad that you're there. I want to say hello. We're going to be creating some more space in Trinity Central during the second service for overflow. And just to let you know, Saturday night we have the exact same service. It starts at 5. And then in the third service, the chapel is available for overflow. We just want to make sure that we're not turning anybody away. And if you have some room between you, maybe you can just kind of scoot in a little bit closer. And that way people that may need to get a seat are able to do so. So y'all feeling blessed today? Yeah? We're feeling blessed? Are you ready for this new year? It's going to be awesome. You know, one important matter of kingdom business that I need to do real quick is I'm so looking forward to James Robinson and our Heartline Banquet. Many of you are new to Trinity, but we have a women's center. God's blessed us with a new location right on Broadway that we're going to be moving into. And we do an annual banquet, and this is where we raise funds for saving lives. Life of the unborn, where we provide free ultrasounds, and the life of the mother also. We provide ministry, ongoing ministry, grace, love, and healing for people who may find themselves in a crisis pregnancy. And it's just so awesome. Like over 25 children's lives were saved last year through Heartline, and we're just expecting God to do bigger and better things in 2015. So this Saturday, you can be a part of a special banquet. And here's what we need to reach our goal. We have about 10 tables left that we need to sell. And you can purchase a table anywhere from $500 donation to a $10,000 donation. So anywhere between a $500 donation for a table, and you can invite friends and family to come be a part of this incredible banquet. James Robinson is an awesome man of God. You're going to be thoroughly, thoroughly blessed. We're going to share a brunch together. So last service I announced this, and I had three people in that service that raised their hand and said, yes, we'll step up and we'll do something big, anywhere from $500 to $10,000. And I'm not asking you to do anything that we haven't already done as far as Carl and Gloria. So I need about five people that say, yeah, we want to be a part of this. We'll do it. We'll go sign up at the table right after this service. So I need about, you need to make a contact with me, five hands, just five people, five families that say, yeah, count me in. Anywhere from 500 to 10,000. You want to see the Cowboys game today? Come on. One, thank you. Two, thank you. Three, thank you, my friend. Bless you. Two more. Four, thank you, my friend. God bless you. Yeah, 500 to 10,000. You're not committing anything between that, okay? One more. We're at four. One more. Thank you, my friend. All right. God bless you. Let's give them a hand. Can we thank the Lord for that? All right. So, as I was praying about this new series for this new year, this phrase, unleash, came in my heart. I'm like, okay, I like that. And I was already thinking about looking at the life of Elisha, okay? Back in 2007, we did a series entitled Ultimate Question, and we did a sermon series on the life of Elijah. There are two dynamic men of God in the Old Testament. Both of them were prophets, Elijah and his protege, his successor, Elisha. And as we look at their life is remarkable. They had some incredible miracles that are recorded in the Bible, and they're there for an inspiration and an example for our own lives. So over the next several weeks, we're going to be looking at the life of Elisha and how the power of God was unleashed in his life. And you're going to find some parallels of how the power of God, the grace of God, and the blessing of God can be unleashed in your own life. So the first message I've entitled, Burn It. And you're going to know here in a moment what that means. Burn it. But before we start, I need to make sure that we all understand the working definition that we're going to be using for this series. And so I looked up the word unleash in the Webster's Dictionary, and here's what it means. To allow or cause something very powerful to happen suddenly. Oh, I love that. I love that definition. To allow or cause something very powerful to happen suddenly. How many of you are open to God unleashing His grace, more of His grace in your life in 2015 to cause something very powerful to happen suddenly? You see, that's what the Cowboys are going to do on Green Bay Packers here in a couple hours. They're going to unleash. Sorry, Packer fans, but you know, hey. We're in Texas. Come on. So Elisha is an amazing individual. Now, there are books in the Bible that were written by prophets. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel. Matter of fact, in my daily devotional, reading through the Bible in a year, which if you haven't started a Bible plan, now is the best time to start a Bible plan. All right? Read through the Bible in a year. Download the Bible app. Right? And it sets you on a calendar of what to read every day, so you can read through the Bible in the calendar year. And I'm reading through the prophets. I just finished Jeremiah. Now I'm in Ezekiel. I woke up this morning. I read through a couple of chapters in the book of Ezekiel. So there are some great prophets that wrote incredible books in the Old Testament. But then, when you come to 1 Kings and 2 Kings, it's a book that was books that were written about prophets, not books that were written by prophets, but books that were written about prophets, in particular to Elijah and Elisha. And the first time Elisha shows up in the Bible, this is important, the first time that Elisha shows up in the Bible, where does he show up? You know, when Moses first shows up in the Bible, he's in a palace. Daniel was in a palace. Nehemiah was in a palace, you know. But the first place that Elisha shows up in the Bible, he is behind a team of oxen plowing in a field. Look at 1 Kings 19:19. It says, so Elijah went and found Elisha, the son of Zarephath, plowing a field. We all have a field that God's assigned us to. We are all, like Elisha, plowing our field. Whatever that field is today may not be the field this next year or the following year or 5 years or 10 years from today, but we all have a field that we're plowing. The field of getting your degree, the field of whatever business or career path you find yourself on today, the field of serving your family and loving your family. So we're all plowing a field. Ultimately, we're all plowing the kingdom field, all right, the kingdom of God. We're all on a field, and we have our hands to the plow. And there were 12 team of oxen in that field, and Elisha was plowing behind the 12th team. Elijah went over to him, threw his cloak across his shoulders, and then walked away. Let's pray. God, we thank you today for the study of Scripture. We thank you that, Lord, the more we understand Scripture, the more we'll understand our own life, our own heart, and the direction that you have for us. The more we understand the Bible, the more that we'll understand what's happening in our world and what's about to happen in our world. So, Lord, help us make the Word of God, the Scriptures, a priority in our life, in our marriages, and in our families. And most importantly, God, of course, in our churches in this new year. We pray and ask this in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Now, Elisha's a plowman. That's not a very glamorous job, right? Or we wouldn't think. I mean, it's demanding work, working behind a plow. Ancient plows were made of iron. They had tree trunk branches stretching out on opposite directions. It was backbreaking, hard, laborious work. And here's Elisha, the man of God, behind this team of oxen plowing in a field. And how many of you know, working behind a team of oxen, plowing in the field all day, how many know that the scenery doesn't change much? If you know what I'm talking about. Two big, ugly, smelly oxes in front of you, right? And that's what you're seeing all day long. And yet, Elisha was doing this as unto the Lord. And it tells us about our own life, that all honest labor, all honest work is rewarded by God. And that literally all work, whatever work you've been assigned to right now in this season in your life, okay, whether it's going to school or working a job or building a business or you're in ministry, you're in vocational ministry like a pastor, an evangelist, or missionary, all work is worship to God. You need to know that. When you show up to work today or tomorrow, this week sometime, you need to know that it is God's assignment for your life and that God's grace is with you and that God's blessing is with you. And we can find meaning in the menial. We can find meaning even behind two smelly oxes, all right, that we're plowing a field. We can do it as unto the Lord. Matter of fact, people in the Bible that were used by God, that were called by God, that had an unleashing moment in their life, they were all busy. I mean, take for example, Moses, he was gainfully employed as a shepherd, and he was actually tending the sheep when God appeared to him in a burning bush. Gideon was threshing wheat when an angel appeared to him. Rebecca was watering camels when Isaac's servant discovered her, and she ends up marrying Isaac, right? Ruth, in the Old Testament, she was working in the field when she met the dream of her life, Boaz. David, young David was working and tending his father's sheep. He was a shepherd when God sent the prophet to his house to anoint the next king over Israel. Nehemiah had a government job when the Lord summoned him. Amos, one of the minor prophets in the Old Testament, Amos was a sheep herder and a sycamore fig farmer. Matthew in the New Testament was collecting taxes when Jesus tapped his shoulder. Peter was in the act of fishing when Jesus showed up in Peter's life. And even the shepherds at the very first Christmas, they were in the field, they were on the job, they were on the clock, they were taking care of sheep when God's angels appeared to them. And then the greatest example of all, Jesus himself. What was Jesus before he entered full-time ministry and began to proclaim the kingdom of God is among you? What was he until the age of 30? He was a carpenter. He worked with his hands. Lift up your hands and look at him. And say to your hands, say, these hands are blessed. Everything these hands touch in 2015 will prosper and be blessed. Because God blesses the work of my hands. Now touch the person next to you and say, be blessed, my friend. Come on, go. Share that blessing now, right? So in all labor, in all work, God rewards it and God blesses it. Don't think, well, because I'm not doing this, because I'm not here, because I'm not there, because my dream has not yet been fulfilled, because I've not reached or attained my goal in my career or my profession or my calling, that what I'm doing is insignificant. I want to remind you today, you're in church today, to be reminded by this preacher speaking on behalf of God from the Holy Scriptures, whatever plow and whatever field you've been assigned to, if it's honest labor, God wants you to know he's with you and his blessing is upon you. And it's while we're busy for God that an unleashing moment can happen. An unleashing moment is what I call a divine interruption or a cloak moment. A cloak moment. What's a cloak moment? It's when God sends his blessing your way, and it's like when Elijah threw the coat, his cloak, the prophet's mantle upon Elisha, that became a defining moment in Elisha's life. We all have these defining moments when God throws a blessing our way, and we have to recognize it. When God throws a cloak of blessing, a new call, a new direction for your life. I know one of the most significant cloak moments in my life happened back in 1989. I had been married for 2 months to Gloria, and I was working full-time at UPS. And the former church I was a part of, the pastor called me up and said, hey, Carl, we would like to invite you to join our ministry team here at the church. And I was like, yes, this is awesome. That was a cloak moment when God threw something new my way, and I recognized it as a God opportunity, and I seized it. Another enormous cloak moment in my life happened back in 2001 when I was faithfully plowing in the field in Albuquerque that God had assigned to me working in the ministry at my former church when an opportunity was presented because God was moving us in a new season, and the board of elders here at Trinity threw a cloak over us and said, come and serve at Trinity. And we said, yes, we are there. So these cloak moments are significant moments in your life and in my life. Now, Elijah was needing a successor. He was about to be taken up to heaven. And we'll look at this in the series because there's another significant moment in Elisha's life when the baton was passed, so to speak. Now, Elijah was about ready to finish his ministry for the Lord. He was God's quarterback. He was calling the calls for God, for the nation of Israel, but his time was about up, and so he needed a successor. And so God sent Elijah to go find his successor, and God said, your successor is a guy by the name of Elisha, son of Zarephath. So Elijah comes and finds Elisha busy, working, right? And he throws the prophet's mantle upon him, and Elisha recognizes that. And we all have these cloak moments. You're wearing a coat today, a coat that God has assigned to you. Some of you have been assigned the coat of military service. That's a calling. Some of you have been assigned the coat of healthcare. That's a calling. Some of you have been served the coat of law enforcement, or the coat of parenting, or the coat of running a business. We all have a coat that God has placed upon us, and we need to receive that. We need to recognize that. We need to honor that. We need to see the blessing behind that, and not be coveting somebody else's cloak, somebody else's coat. We all have a field that we've been assigned to. We don't want to, be covetous of somebody else's field. Like, we're in our field. We're like, man, I don't like my field, man. My field seems worse than that person's field. I want to be in that person's field. God is saying, I didn't assign you to that person's field. I assigned that person to that field. I've assigned you to this field. And so we are satisfied, not content, but we are satisfied with the assignment that God has given us, knowing that as we are faithful, God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him, and that God will always expand and God will always grow His blessings in our lives. And basically, we all have a team of oxen. We all have a yoke that we have fastened ourselves to. But not every yoke is God's yoke. Not every yoke is a good yoke. Some people are yoked to a destructive habit, that God wants to break that yoke in your life in this new year. Some have a yoke to an addiction, or some have a yoke to depression, or a yoke of sorrow, or a yoke of grief, or a yoke of debt. How many millions of Americans are harnessed to a yoke of debt? And God wants to set you free from that yoke of debt. He wants to use this service today to throw a mantle of grace and a mantle of blessing your way that says God is going to give you a new assignment. God wants you to turn in your old yoke for a new yoke, and He wants you to be harnessed to His yoke and not this destructive yoke that's weighing you down. How many of you know that the world has a yoke that is dehumanizing? The world. There's the yoke of sexual bondage. There's the yoke of pornography. There's the yoke of alcoholism. There's the yoke of drug addiction. And possibly the most devious, the most satanic, the most hideous yoke of all is the yoke of religion. You see, when Jesus came into this world, the strongest yoke that was over the minds and hearts and lives of people was the yoke of religion, which is a yoke of bondage. And God can break the yoke of bondage. The Bible says it's the anointing that breaks the yoke. But the most powerful yoke could be the yoke of religion. Look at billions of people that are deceived, billions of people that have been beguiled by a yoke of religion, a religion that is Christless and bloodless and crossless, a yoke of religion that motivates people to kill other innocent people. There are people that are bound by this yoke of religion, and we need to pray that God's mercy and God's grace would be poured out across this planet of ours, and that a revival would come so that people can be delivered from that yoke of godless, Christless, bloodless, crossless religion in our world. The most hideous yoke that Jesus had to deal with when He was on the earth was the yoke of religion. People were bound by Judaism. They were bound by man-made rules and traditions. And the greatest animosity that came the way of Jesus was that came from those who were bound by the yoke of religion. I pray that if you're bound by the yoke of religion, you'll trade that yoke in for the yoke of Jesus. If you're bound by a yoke of addiction, whatever that yoke is, it's not the yoke of heaven. That's not the yoke of the Lord Jesus, that you would be set free. Look at what Jesus said about His yoke in Matthew 11, 28, 29, and 30. Come to Me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Everybody say rest. Yes. Take My yoke upon you and learn from Me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find, say that word with me, rest for your souls. Now read this last part out loud with me together. For My yoke is easy and My burden is light. One more time. For My yoke is easy and My burden is light. The yoke Christ has for you is no joke, okay? And His yoke is easy and His burden is light. What have you been harnessed to this year? What does God want to unleash in your life? Are you willing to trade in the old yoke, the yoke of bondage, for the yoke that Christ has for you so that we could be in His field doing His work, His way? Look at what Jesus said in Luke 9:62. But Jesus told him, anyone who puts a hand to the plow and then looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. In 2015, God has assigned us to a field. God has assigned us to his plow. We are yoked to Jesus, and we want both hands firmly fastened to that yoke, and we don't want to be looking back. We don't want to be looking back to the old life. We want to be looking back to the old year. It's gone. We don't want to be looking back to Egypt like the children of Israel. They continually kept looking back. And if you and I keep looking back, we will find an excuse and we will find a way to go back. But God does not want us to go back to the old ways. God does not want us to go back to the old life. Everything that God has before you and everything that God has for you is not behind you. Everything that God has for you is in front of you. Your past may be spotted. Your past may be checkered, but your future in Jesus is bright. Come on, look to your neighbor and tell him your future looks bright. Amen. And when we are faithfully in our field serving God and working the plow that he's assigned to us, then that cloak moment can come. That moment of divine interruption can come in your life and in my life. It's interesting to me that Elisha wasn't praying when Elijah came and found him. And there's nothing wrong with praying. Please, I hope we pray more in this year than we did last year. He wasn't reading the Bible when Elijah found him. And please understand, reading the Bible is significant and important. What he was doing, he was simply working. In the midst of doing life can become the greatest opportunities for God to show up and bring blessing into your life. So how did Elisha respond? Well, look at verse 20. It says, and he left the oxen, and he ran after Elijah and said, please, let me, what's that next word? Kiss. Say it again. Kiss. Aren't you glad God gave us kissing? I mean, kissing's fun. If it's with your wife, or, you know, your spouse, right? I mean, kissing your wife's fun. Yeah, it's fun, yeah. It doesn't, you know, 27 years of this, I still enjoy it, right? Kissing your kids is fun. I mean, the most intimate expression of friendship and love is a kiss that you share with your spouse, or a kiss that you share with your children, or your grandchildren, or maybe a nephew, or maybe a niece. Never a dog, never a pet. I'm not into that, you know. Kiss the hand, dog, kiss the hand. Don't get close to here. That's for my wife, that's for my sons, right? You know, the Bible has a lot to say about kissing. If we really wanted to be scriptural in this new year and follow everything the Bible teaches, the Bible commands us, instructs us, that we're to kiss one another with a holy kiss. Now, your handshake's good for me, though. I'll just say it right there. You know, we're from America, and Americans aren't into that. You go to Latin America, it's different. Like, hey, when in Latin America, do as Latin. Mwah, mwah. You know, if you're Italian or you go back to Italy, whatever, it's like they kiss you on the cheek. And that's kind of cool. I mean, I don't want to introduce that here because then after church, we'd have to be kissing one another on the way out. Let's just stick to the handshake. I think there's certain things the Lord just permits, okay? What I love about this is that Elisha understood the moment, how significant it was, and he knew he needed to take care of business. And the business that he needed to take care of is he needed to go and kiss his father and mother goodbye. You know what that tells us? That tells us a lot. That tells us that, first of all, Elisha was raised in a good home, in a godly home. I hope you've had the privilege to be raised in a good home, in a godly home. I know there are many of us that were not raised in a good and godly home. And one description of a good and godly home is that both the father and the mother are present for the child. I know sometimes it doesn't work out that way. I was raised in a single-parent family by my mom. And so I know what it's like to be raised in a single home, and I know that God can compensate for that. I know God compensates for that. He did in my own life. But what happened for me was, as I was raised in a single home, I realized the value of having both the father and the mother present. So I said, God, when I got saved, I said, God, help me to be that father that's always present for my children. Amen. And so even if something bad has happened, and maybe, you know, you and the mother of your children, or you and the father of your children have split up, and maybe coming back together is not a possibility, but you know what? How many know we can still be a part of our kids' lives? That when they come to important transitions in their life, that they know that we're still there for them, and they want to come back and say, God, Mom, Dad, I want to give you one final kiss because I'm about to go change the world for Jesus. And that we're there for our children. How many know we need to be there for our children, no matter what the circumstances may be in your life right now? I don't judge or condemn anybody. I know tough things happen, life happens, things happen. But the best way, the best way, the best way, if you have any control over your future, the best way is that our children are able to come home and both mom and dad are there to greet them and to love them and to encourage them. So I love this. Elisha goes home to kiss his father and his mother goodbye. I'm glad he kissed his mom and dad and not the oxen. Amen. What does this mean to you? Here's what it means to you. If you're going to experience an unleashing moment of God's grace and favor in your life, and God's going to take you to a new place in 2015, listen to me very carefully. Listen to me very, very carefully. There's some things you're going to have to kiss goodbye. You're going to have to kiss the good life goodbye for the better life that God has for you. You're going to have to kiss goodbye the ordinary life for the extraordinary life that God has for you. You're going to have to kiss goodbye that which you're familiar with so that you can embrace the remarkable life that God's calling you and I into in 2015. Get your kisser ready, because there's going to be some things you're going to have to kiss goodbye to really experience everything that God has for you in 2015. I mean, no, we need to kiss goodbye 2014, because it's over. All the good, all the bad, all the ugly, all the highs, all the lows, all the ups, all the downs. We got to say goodbye 2014. Some people are still stuck in the 70s, or stuck in the 80s, or stuck in the 90s, or stuck in the 2000s. We've got to kiss the past goodbye. The past is the past. We can't go back. We can't change it. But our future in Jesus, I believe, is bright. Amen. And it's going to get better in Jesus' name. This past month in December, my wife and I had the distinct privilege to travel to Los Angeles, and we were invited by Pastor Matthew Barnett and Pastor Tommy Barnett to be a part of their service. They have a midweek Thursday night service at Angeles Temple, and we were able to first tour the Dream Center. And the Dream Center is a dream, and dreams that have been broken are being restored at the Dream Center. They house literally hundreds and hundreds of individuals who hit a streak of bad luck, who made some wrong turns in life, who made some bad decisions in life, like we all have. But sometimes decisions stick with you. And sometimes a decision or a choice will take you down a path you never intended to go. And sometimes there are events that happen in your life and in my life that are totally beyond our control and our ability to control. And sometimes life happens and the bottom falls out from under us. And we were at the Dream Center, and we toured the men's dormitory, and we toured the women's dormitory, and we were able to hear some of these individuals who are in a one-year or a two-year program, and then they graduate, and then they go back out in the world better prepared to be productive citizens living their life for Jesus. And we were in the women's dormitory, and several women stood up and shared their testimony, and it brought tears to our eyes and joy to our heart. One particular young woman stood up and she said, "My life's changed since Jesus came into my life, since I arrived here at the Dream Center 2 years ago." She said, "My life was horrendous. Starting out at a very young age, one of my close family members violated me, sexually abused me. It was out of her control. It wasn't her fault, but it happened. And that led her into a life of gross immorality. Sexual partner after sexual partner, she began to strip in the clubs. She got involved in prostitution. Next thing she knew, she found out that she was pregnant, and that became a defining moment in her life. And there was a godly, God-fearing, loving Christian that God sent across her pathway that intercepted her at that moment in her life and told her, talked to her about Jesus, told her about the Dream Center. She ends up at the Dream Center. She has her child. Now, 2 years later, she's the best mom you could ever have imagined. She's about ready to go back into this real world. She's about ready to be the person that God's called her to be. She said, "My past is my past. I can't go back and change it, but I thank God that I have a bright future in Jesus, and He's changed my life. I'm not the same woman I used to be." She had an unleashing moment in her life. The cloak was thrown her way, and she absorbed it, and she received it, and she was now saying, "I kiss my old life goodbye to embrace the new life that God has for me." And the next thing that Elisha did, look at verse 21. It says, "So Elisha turned back from him and took a yoke of oxen and slaughtered them and boiled their flesh using the oxen's equipment. And he gave it to the people and they ate." A celebration punctuated by a catered meal from Rudy's. That's what I'm talking about. Brisket for everyone. He had been behind those oxen long enough. He kept thinking, "One day, you're going to be lunch." I'm sorry, all the vegetarians out there, okay? So this is a moment of great celebration. What does he do? He kills the oxen, and he burns the plow. There's a phrase that was made popular in history back in 1519. The Spanish conquistador Hernando Cortez he landed in Mexico on the shores of the Yucatan, and he had one objective. One objective was he wanted to seize all the gold that was hoarded by the Aztecs. Cortez was so committed to this one mission that when they landed, he gave the command to his men to burn the ships so that they would know we've got one of two options here. Either we win or we die. There's no turning back. You know, sometimes in life we need to burn the ship. Or in Elisha's case, we need to be willing to burn the plow, sacrifice the oxen, take what we have been involved in our life and say, now God, I dedicate this to you, I sacrifice this to you, I offer this up to you. God, I am willing to burn the ship behind me. Sometimes there are moments of transition in your life when you have to be willing to burn the ship. You see, Elisha was saying by this act, I'm not coming back. I'm not coming back. Where God is taking me is going to be an adventure. I don't know ultimately where I'm going to end up, but I know one thing. I will never be back harnessed to this same plow again. I'm going to make sure of it. I'm going to burn this bad boy. Are you willing to burn the plows in your life? Are you and I willing to burn our old life and our old ways and our old thinking and offer it up to God today, this week, this month, this year, as a sacrifice to God, as a significant act that says the past is the past, the old is the old, it's out with the old and it's in with the new, and have our own burning ceremony? You know, in the book of Acts, the power of God was unleashed in the lives of people who had been involved in occultic practice and worship of demons and devils. And the grace of God invaded their life to such an extent that they brought all of their occultic paraphernalia and they had a bonfire. Look at what it says in the book of Acts, chapter 19. And beginning in verse 19, it says, a number of them who had been practicing sorcery brought their incantation books and burned them at a public bonfire. How awesome is that? What if I said next Sunday, I want you to bring all your occultic stuff, all your pornography, all your drug paraphernalia, all the symbols of the things that Satan has used in your life, in my life, at some point in time, to bring us into bondage, and we're going to bring them all, we're going to take them out in the parking lot, we're going to pile them all up together, and we're going to have the biggest bonfire in the city of Lubbock next Sunday. Well, first of all, we couldn't do that because the fire department wouldn't give us a permit to do that, and if we did that, I'd be getting arrested, and I don't feel like being arrested, okay? So symbolically, let's do it. How's that? True story. And I need to end. Many years ago, about 26 years ago, my wife and I were asleep. It was a Halloween night. Went to bed. And we headed up a singles ministry. And in that singles ministry, there were some singles leaders that were reaching out to some people that were really in a bad way spiritually. One girl in particular was a Satan worshiper. Many of you may not believe in this stuff, but this is the way it happened. She was a Satan worshiper. She came to their home for this Bible study after she had just got finished with an occultic party, right? She came, and she began to manifest demons. Once again, this might scare some of you. Some of you think, man, I don't believe in that. I'm telling you, this is exactly how it happened. We get a phone call about 1 in the morning and said, hey, Pastor, can you come over? This girl, you know, they explained what was going on. I said, yeah. So my wife and I got up. We went over to this apartment, happened to be in our same apartment complex that we were living at that time. And there is this woman, full-blown, I mean, exorcism, the right, you know, I mean, this. She was writhing on the floor, making sounds that were not human. Maybe she was on drugs, I know she was drunk, okay? But this was real. We began to pray and intercede and pray and intercede. And about an hour into it, the power of Satan broke over her life. True story. She collapsed, fell asleep, slept like a baby. We went back home. They called us the next morning and said, you need to come over and see her. We went over to see her. She was totally transformed. Her eyes were clear. Her face was different. There was a glow on her countenance. And we began to disciple her. And we said, you know what? Hey, all that satanic stuff in your life, man, you need to get rid of it. She's like, how? I said, well, look, we read the Bible here. And I said, let's burn it. So she brought it to the church, and we put it in a shopping cart. And we poured some gasoline on it, and we lit that bad boy stuff on fire. Man, it just went up in smoke, all this plastic that was burning, all these toxins that were going up. Just not good to do, right? But we were excited. She was excited because that was significant that she was saying goodbye to her old life. She was burning all the roots back to her old life because she said, I don't want to go back to that old life any longer. And we celebrated this moment with her. And about 3 days later, the mom called and said, I heard what you did to my daughter's belongings. She said, you better pay me or I'm going to sue you. So we wrote her a check for $300. But anyway, true story. Best $300 we ever spent as a church. And look at what it says. Let's end here. So it says verse 21, he boiled the flesh using the oxen, gave to the people, and they ate. Then he arose, the last part of the verse, 1 Kings 19:21. Then he arose and followed Elijah and became his. Are you kidding me? I mean, he's leaving all this behind, kissing his parents goodbye, kissing his past goodbye, killing the oxen, burning the plow, never to return, to do what? Be a servant to the man of God? Yes. Because we are never more like Jesus than when we are serving others. You know, Elisha served Elijah for 10 years. For the next 10 years, Elisha was willing to be the best at second best, was willing to be the servant that poured water on the hands of Elijah, as it says in 2 Kings chapter 3, for the next 10 years until another unleashing moment came into Elisha's life. Listen, you and I are never more like Jesus than when we are serving, because you see, this is also a story of Jesus. Jesus burned the plow in heaven. He laid down the crown. He laid down the scepter. He took down off the robe, and he humbled himself and became a man, and he humbled himself even further and became a servant. And when Jesus was in this sin-cursed world of ours, he didn't reach for a throne. He didn't reach for a crown. He didn't reach for fame. He didn't reach for popularity. He didn't reach for power. He didn't reach for wealth. You know what he reached for? He reached for a towel that he placed around himself when he got on his knees to wash the feet of his disciples. You know what Jesus reached for? He reached for an old rugged cross on a hill called Calvary, and it was there that he laid down his life, and he served the entire world and provided redemption and forgiveness and healing and salvation for all who would come and for all who would believe, Jew and Gentile, male and female, rich and poor, whosoever will, let him come and drink freely of the waters of life. Aren't you thankful that Jesus burned the plow? He burned the bridge. He burned the ships. And he came and gave us his all. Can we thank him for that as we close today? Thank you, Lord Jesus. I came across this saying. I don't know where it originated, but it's a good quote. We die by living to ourselves. We live by dying to ourselves. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Father, I pray that we would just have an unleashing moment, a cloak moment, a divine interruption moment in our own lives today. I pray that, Lord, whatever we need to kiss goodbye, for some that are leaving singlehood into marriage, they need to kiss their singlehood life goodbye. They need to burn the plow of being single. Some are leaving marketplace ministry to enter into vocational ministry. They need to burn the plow behind them. Lord, some are transitioning from college to the workplace, and they need to burn the plow behind them. They need to embrace this new direction that you have for their life. God, I thank you that those who have yokes of bondage, that this year they're going to be broken in Jesus' name, for it's the anointing that breaks the yoke. And I pray, Lord God, that they would be ready to burn the yoke, kill the oxen, and follow Jesus, to serve Jesus, and to serve the cause of Christ for the rest of their life, beginning today. With heads bowed and eyes closed, if you're here today, and you're not where you'd like to be in your relationship with Jesus, that's okay, you're in the right place. You've never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. This is the moment. Today's the day of salvation. Jesus is standing at the door of your heart knocking. All you simply need to do is open up the door of your heart. Invite Christ into your life. Just pray this prayer out loud with the rest of us. Say it with your own mouth. Mean it from your own heart. For Scripture promises, if you'll confess Jesus as Lord and Savior, you will be saved. Dear God in heaven, I know I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. There's only one Savior. His name is Jesus. I call upon you, Jesus. I ask you now, come into my heart. Come into my life. Be my Lord, be my Savior. I turn from sin to the true and living God. I receive His love, His grace, and His forgiveness. Dear God in heaven, You're now my Father, and I am Your child. Fill me now with Your Holy Spirit and give me strength to live for You and serve You all the days of my life, beginning today, for the rest of my life, for all of eternity. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Can we thank the Lord together, church family?